Happy Lord's Day. Happy Father's Day. As we come to God's house through our online streaming, once again, to worship the Lord on His day, to worship and to thank Him and to praise Him. I want to say Happy Father's Day to every one of our fathers. I want to say Happy Father's Day to mine. Cortland, Pop, we love you and we thank you. And I thank you for being the man of God that you are. We've come today to praise the Lord Jesus Christ. We come today to celebrate our last online streaming without people, you, the family, in the pews. Next Sunday, Lord willing, we will be able to once again regather, to come in person, and to worship the Lord Jesus Christ together. Our online live streaming will continue for now on. It's part of who we are. So if you join us every week on online, but you're not able to come worship with us, or if you just are uncomfortable and not ready to come back, there's no pressure there. You will be able to continue to join us online. The streaming will be live. The only difference, it'll be 10:45 instead of 10 a.m. Can't wait to see everybody next Sunday. Can't wait to worship each other together once again. Let's celebrate this morning with our family video, We Are the Church. We all need each other to be all that God wants us to be.
We are the church.
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 We serve an awesome God.
We are the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
And we are the church.
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 We need each other to be all that God wants us to be.
We are the church.
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 And I want to be back in that little church real, real soon.
We are the church.
As it is Father's Day this day, again, I'm so grateful for all the men in my life that have been godly influence, a witness, a testimony, a mentor, and a friend. I have way too many to mention. I have been blessed in many different ways by godly men in my lives. So I thank you all, and I praise you. I praise the Lord Jesus Christ for putting you in my life, and I thank you. One of the prayers that I have as a father is that my life will be pleasing to Him, that my life will be worthy of His gift of salvation, forgiveness, and joy, and that my decisions and my wisdom will come from Him, that my direction will come from Him, that He will be my vision, and that I will always follow Him in every decision I make, with every comment, with every thought, with every reaction. It'll be your vision, your will, Lord Jesus Christ. So what better song to start out singing this morning? Lord, be thou my vision.
for sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with thee, Lord. Thou my great Father, and I thy true Son.
Morning, Barnesville Baptist. I hope this day finds you well. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for your faithfulness to watch over us, to guide us and protect us, Father. Father, we ask that you be with each and every one of those that are sick and hurting. Father, we ask that you just be with all the families. Father, give them peace with all the things that are going on around them. Let them know, Father, that you are at work. Father, we thank you again just for all things. As the Lord has taught us to pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Sam. If you'd join me with the responsive reading. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love, with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up together, and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building, being fitted together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit.
Amen. Thank you for that written word as we read and as we went to the Lord in prayer. Now, as we get together and come to our next song, Stand Up for Jesus. What a beautiful song. What better time than now to remind us as fathers that we must stand on our foundation of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we must stand up and proclaim the good news. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We must stand on that. And as fathers, we must be the example that we are. Maybe you're asking yourself now, how can I be the example? I've failed so many times. I've not been a good father. Maybe that's the situation you find yourself in. I have great news for you. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will forgive you. He will restore you. He will renew you. And you can be the father that he always designed and planned for you to be, to lead your household by calling on the power, the forgiveness, the salvation, the wisdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we are to stand on that. So let's stand up out of our chairs, out of our bed, out of our side of the pool, out of the car. By the way, it's the last Sunday you're going to be able to do that. Amen. You're going to be here worshiping if you're comfortable. Again, let me say that. If you're not comfortable in coming back this next Sunday, please join us on live streaming. No one will think the difference. You must be at peace and have comfort. But let's stand right now and sing this beautiful song. Stand Up for Jesus.
Time is royal power.
Amen. What a beautiful song. Stand up for Jesus. That's the one thing we need to remember. If we stand up for Jesus, if we stand on that foundation that's firm, all things will be good in our life. This morning, I'm pleased to announce praise that once again, every one of our family members, our tenders, our visitors is virus free. And we give the Lord the praise and the honor for that. We had a little scare this week. One of our family members in our Barnesville Baptist family was ill and had all the signs of maybe having the virus. And they went to the hospital and they had the test and they got the great news that it was negative. We give the Lord the praise for that. Amen. If you're home, give him a hand. Give him a clap of appreciation for how the Lord is protecting us, continues to protect us, and will gather around us. I have been praying as your shepherd. I've asked the deacons to pray, and I'm asking you to pray that as we gather again next Sunday, as we celebrate coming back after so long of not being able to gather together in person, I pray that we cry out to the Lord for protection. I pray that this holy land will be blessed and protected like it always has been. I've been praying clearly, specifically, that the Lord would bind evil from this holy land, that he would bind evil from our families, that he would bind the virus, the COVID-19, and not allow it to come into the holy land that we stand on, that we worship on, not allow it to interfere in any of our families and our church. And I know God is faithful. Amen. Now is our time for offering. I appreciate everything you're doing, how you're providing, how you're being faithful. God is providing, but how you're being faithful, mailing in your tithes and using the online services that we have on our website and the app that we have that you can give your tithes and offerings online. We ask you again to continue to support and be faithful to your church. You can mail them in. Again, just put giving right on the envelope. The envelope immediately is put in a bigger envelope. That bigger envelope is delivered on Monday to David, our treasurer. None of your envelopes are written. That's all privileged, confidential between you and the Lord and our treasurer and our tellers. So you can mail it in. P.O. Barnesville Baptist Church, P.O. Box 69. Barnesville, Maryland, 20838. Or you can go on our website, in the top right-hand corner of our website, click on giving, and you can see you can give by a debit card, credit, or by check now, which is a lot more efficient and a whole lot less expensive to do it that way. We thank you and we praise you, and let's give the Lord a prayer. Lord, I go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, I thank you for all the tithes and offerings. I thank you how you're providing in mighty ways protection, love, mercy, grace, and yes, the finances to continue the good work here at Barnesville, your church, right here on this hill. May you bless all the givers. May you bless us, and may we be good stewards with everything you've given us. And we ask this in your precious name. Amen. Join me in our doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and
kids, now it's time for our children's story. Please gather around the computer, the TV, the phone, whatever you're watching it on, and let's watch Miss Megan as she brings us the children's story.
Good morning and happy Father's Day. Today's lesson is about being a light in the world. These are flashlights. You mostly use one if you're going someplace dark, like camping, or if the power goes out. God wants us to be the lights in the world. He wants to use our words and actions to shine the light of Christ for everyone to see. He wants us to be nice and do good things. Sometimes the world can be dark and people aren't always so kind. This means we, as Christians, need to be the light in our world. We can do this in simple ways. For example, opening the door for someone is a simple but kind thing to do. It can easily make someone's day. Another great way to be a light is by making a handmade card to send or give to someone. It's important to check on others and make sure they know they are loved. God gives us hope when things get rough. Like a flashlight, He is our light. So instead of just letting the door shut behind you next time, think of others. Hold the door open. Be the light. Draw a picture and send it to a friend. Be the light. Now let us pray. Dear God, thank you for our many blessings. Help us to be and see the good in the world. Thank you today especially for our fathers and father figures. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Bye, Barnesville Baptist. Can't wait to see you real soon.
Amen. Amen and amen. I would like to stop for a moment and say thank you to everyone that participated in the last 3 months since March by making videos, by going out of your way to drop them off, to send them. It's been fun trying to figure out how to send them, where to send them, what mode to send them in, what way. If you could see Luke right now, his hair is grayer than ever. But he made it through. And I want to thank Luke for the many different ways we sent information to him, and he brought it out every week through the wisdom God gave him to give us a clear picture. But I want to thank every single one of you that has participated. I want to thank everyone who's been following us, and I want to urge you to continue to be part of the family. You are part of the Barnesville Baptist Church family. That will not change. Continue to worship with us online. It will be live streaming. Again, it'll be 10:45, but it'll be live streaming. You'll be part of the church family. You will always be, because as a believer in Jesus, we are the family of God. Again, today is Father's Day, a time that we come together to thank our fathers. But I know as a father, it's also a time to reflect. This little video is kind of funny. I found it and sent it to Luke to air today. It reminded me of how hard it is for men to say, I love you. How hard, and I don't understand why, but I know it's hard at times for us to show our emotions, to sincerely say, I love you, or I'm sorry, or whatever else that we have trouble sharing as men. I'm proud to be a father. I'm proud of my daughter, Kimberly Gaynor. I'm proud that she is raising her children in a Christ-like manner in her home. I prayed for her. When we got married, I prayed our first child would be a beautiful little girl, and that's exactly what God gave me. Kim, you are a blessing to me. You are a gift to me, and I'm so proud of you. I'm very proud of my son, William. I'm proud of who he is in Christ, and I am excited to see what God has in store for him in the future. I'm proud that he has never been embarrassed to scream out, I love you, to hug me. Just this morning he called, first thing, and said, I love you. I'm grateful for that. I know one thing, I love my family, but I thank the Lord Jesus Christ that I'm part of the family of God, aren't you? That's the greatest blessing ever. Join me in this little video, and men, maybe we can figure out a way to say I love you today.
Dad, I'm just going to say it. I don't know why it's hard for me to talk real with you, but it is. And all we ever do is talk weather and sports and weather, and that's it. I don't know. What I really want to say is I'm thankful for how you loved me growing up, and you always made time for me, and I love you. Happy Father's Day.
That was really good.
You think?
Yeah, you need to tighten it up a little bit, but other than that, you're ready.
Okay, thanks, Uncle Ron. Here goes.
Good.
that,
son.
Looks like the clouds are rolling in.
Yeah, hope they don't postpone the game tonight.
Listen, Dad, I wanted to say something to you.
Okay.
I just want to thank you for being, you know, a dad. Not just a dad, you know, being one that's mine, and not, well, of course not just mine. You're Jessica and Jordan's dad too, but it's cool.
Matthew.
Yes, sir.
I know.
Dad, I don't think you do know.
No, oh, no, I know. I heard you talking to Uncle Ron. I was sitting just 4 feet from you.
Well, I meant it.
Thank you.
Well, I hit it home. Men, let's be proud to say, I love you. I need you. And I'm grateful that you're my children, my wife, my brother, my father, my mother, everyone God's given us. If we haven't learned anything in these last 3 months, I pray that we have learned to appreciate each other in a Christ-like way. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for this opportunity to come and to look at your word, to celebrate our fathers, but most importantly, to celebrate the Father, God Almighty, Jehovah. As we look at your word this morning, truly has touched my heart already. And I am grateful for my Father, and I love him. And I want you to know, Father Jehovah, my Heavenly Father, I am so grateful for you. And I want to be like your Son in everything I say and do. Give me the power and the wisdom. Forgive me where I failed you. Speak through me, Holy Spirit, this day. I know for a fact you'll give me a new start right now, a fresh new beginning. And I still, as long as I have breath, can be the father you want me to be. So let that start today. Don't let me look back on my past. Don't let it be a crutch or excuse or a reason not to move ahead. Let it fuel us to move ahead in you, guiding us, protecting us. And I pray that the families will accept the genuine, heartfelt new creation that you bring into all men, all people. And we praise your name. Amen and amen. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above. He reigns with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Have you personally experienced how awesome God is lately? Have you taken the time, and time seems like all we've had, have you taken the time to grow closer to God, the Father? Have you taken this time to read his word? I want to challenge you that you, whatever time you have left, whatever free time or make time to get to know the Word of God more, to get to know your Father, the Heavenly Father, to put the time in to know how awesome and beautiful and powerful and loving our Father is. Have you seen and felt the power and the love of the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Great I Am, Jesus? He's reaching out to us even now. This morning, through God's word, we're going to be looking at Revelations chapter 4, 2 through 6. And I want us to get a glimpse of this beautiful picture the Lord has allowed us to have of heaven. To get a glimpse of the throne of the Heavenly Father. To get a glimpse to see what our reward, our future, our eternal life will be like. I want us to look at Revelations 4, 2 through 6. And as we read it, I want to encourage you to let everything clear your mind. Don't worry about the bills. They'll be there when we're done. Don't worry about what you're going to eat this afternoon or who's coming and who isn't coming. Don't let anything interfere. Don't let the virus, don't let this evil world rob you of this beautiful insight of what Jesus is sharing with us and through the word of heaven and the heavenly throne of our heavenly Father. Imagine, if you would, exactly what heaven will look like. Revelations 4, 2 through 6. At once I was in the Spirit. This is John speaking from the Isle of Patmos. At once I was in the Spirit, and there before me was a throne in heaven with someone sitting on it. And the one who sat there had the appearance of jasper and ruby, a rainbow that shone like an emerald encircled the throne. Surrounding the throne were 24 other thrones, and seated on them were 24 elders. They were dressed in white and had crowns of gold on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning, rumbles, and peals of thunder. In front of the throne, seven lamps were blazing. These are the seven spirits of God. Also in front of the throne, there was what I saw looked like a sea of glass, clear as crystal. In the center around the throne were four living creatures, and they were covered with eyes in front and in back. Thank you, Lord, for your word. The very first picture that we see in our glimpse of heaven is the sovereign Lord and King Jehovah. Listen to me, there's only one throne. There's only one seated on that throne, and that is Jehovah, God Almighty. Remind you of that once again. There is only one throne, and that throne, I'm talking about the throne of God, not the ones encircling it. There is only one throne, and on that throne is only seated one, Jehovah, God Almighty. The word throne is all through this chapter, and it actually, in the book of Revelations, the word throne appears 50 times. It's how important it is. So I thought, let's look and see what that represents. What does the throne represent? The first thing I see is that the throne of God represents authority that our Father God has on everything, everybody, all things created, all things are sustained, and under Jehovah God's authority. Given to the Lord Jesus Christ to reign for his will to be done. God is in control. He's the one on the throne, and he has the last word. I think we really need to hear that even more today. God, Jehovah, is the only one seated on the throne, and the one on the throne has all authority, and he has the last word. Not Satan, not this world, not evil, not sickness, not disappointments, not even sin. God has authority over all things, the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, and they have the last word. Let's stand on that and believe that. The throne tells me there's only one true living God. As I see this glimpse of heaven, I see I have one living, true living Father. I have one beautiful Savior, the Son, the only begotten Son of God, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit dwelling within me. We are to worship God who is seated on this throne. We are to submit and humble ourselves to his authority. We are to submit and humble ourselves to his love. We are to submit and humble ourselves to his grace, his mercy. And we are to be thankful. We are to be grateful. We are to appreciate every blessing that comes poured down from heaven above, because all good things are from the Father, God Almighty. We are to trust in that wisdom. We are to trust in his love. We are to trust in the authority he has on all things. As we looked at Revelations 4, verse 3, I'll remind you again. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and ruby. And around the throne was a rainbow that he had appearance of an emerald. One of the first things I thought of was how beautiful the Lord must have been and is. And this vision that John had. And how much more beautiful and how much more in awe and holiness than we can ever imagine or put into words. God is the creator, the sustainer, the provider for all things. And he sits on the throne and he loves us. He sent his son, Jesus, to die on the cross so that we would have access to the throne, so that we could be made right in our relationship with the Father through the precious blood of his son, Jesus Christ. Come on, church, let's get an amen. Come on, church, let's be the people God wants us to be. Come on, men, let's be the fathers, the men God wants us to be. And have faith in knowing him. John, as he saw the Lord in his entire splendor, words failed him. All he could think about was the beauty, the awe, the glory, the power, the love, the authority. All he could see and think about, all he could imagine was one of to help describe this for you and I was to use the most beautiful, precious stones and emeralds and diamonds and gold. And these descriptions were the most beautiful to him. So he used it. And I'm sure even that didn't do justice to how beautiful our Lord is. The main message here is simple, that the Lord is awesome in beauty, filled with love, wisdom, power, and all glory is due him. All glory is due him. We've said this throughout the entire time we have been in lockdown, or we have been safe and trying to be good, make good decisions based on everyone's health and the virus that has been running rampant. We've been saying this throughout. The church has not been closed. Yes, we have not been able to gather together in person, but the church has never been closed. Folks, our church, God's church, his church has grown stronger than ever through all this time, because the church is where you will find peace, rest, and salvation and security and refuge. Because what do you find? It's not the building. It's not the walls. It's not the property. It's the Lord Jesus Christ, the head of the church. It's the Lord Jehovah God Father, who the Lord Jesus Christ intercedes on our behalf every single moment of every day. It's the Holy Spirit dwelling in within us as believers, who dwells and speaks to the Son Jesus, who intercedes for us. And we have access to the throne because of love, grace, and mercy. Let's get an amen going, church, as we move forward in who we are. He's full of wisdom, power, and glory. And why wouldn't he be? Why shouldn't he be? Jesus is King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the only begotten Son of God. And he is my Savior, and he is my Redeemer. And I'm not ashamed to say I love him. I love him with every aspect, every part, from head to toe. I love the Lord Jesus. I am grateful to my Lord Jesus. I am grateful for my salvation. I am grateful for forgiveness. I am grateful for fresh starts and new beginnings where my past has been wiped clean and I can start brand new. I'm thankful to my Lord Jesus, who doesn't condemn me and remind me every moment and every day like this evil world will do about my past. But he tells me, no, your past is gone. Use that memory. Use those thoughts. Use that pain to fuel you to be the man I want you to be now, Danny. Exactly what he's done for you also. You know, I remember a vacation not too long ago. Actually, it's been many years ago. And I was in Canada, where my home folks are from. And I love that area. I love that part of the world. So peaceful there in Westover, Nova Scotia. And as I was sitting at Peggy's Cove in Nova Scotia, just 3 or 4 miles from the homestead where everybody in my family on my dad's side is, I happened to be over sitting on a rock overlooking the sea. And I looked down and there was my family. And I remember it clearly. My daughter, my son, my wife, my cousin Lorraine, who was always with us. And I remember saying, Lord, how beautiful is your creation. For miles and miles, nothing but rock and tree and beauty, shoreline. For as far as you could see, ocean. Then my family that you gave me, my daughter, my son, my grandchildren, my wife, you gave me this family, and they were right there in the midst of the creation, and it was so beautiful. That scene has never lost my been erased from my mind because it was so powerful. How much different it'll be and how much more beautiful with the throne when I approach the throne of God. When he calls me home, how much more beautiful it'll be to embrace and to see the glory of my Father Jehovah, to see the nail-pierced hands and feet of my Savior Jesus Christ, and to hear those beautiful words, "Welcome home, my son. Welcome home. Join me at the supper of the Lamb." How beautiful it'll be to be in the presence of God the Father, the one who created everything, every flower, every star, every living, breathing thing. Beauty isn't the only thing we see, though, church. I could end it there, but I wouldn't be doing you good or just as your shepherd. We also see judgment at this throne. We also experience the power and the judgment and the authority that God Almighty has, Jehovah, at the throne. In verse 5, John tells us that from the throne came flashes of lightning, rumbles, and peals of thunder. You know, when the Israelites were delivered from Egypt, and when they reached Mount Sinai, God's glory came down to the mountain to reveal himself to Israel. And listen to what was said. Exodus 19, 16 through 17. On the morning of the third day, there were thunders and lightnings and a thick cloud on the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast, so that all the people in the camp trembled. Then Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God, and they took their stand at the foot of the mountain. If you read on, you can see they were terrified because of the holiness, the glory, the power, the authority of God Almighty. You know, power and judgment's a different picture than the beauty, isn't it? But it's part of who God is. It's part of the Word of God. It's part of the vision John received to share with you and I. Lightning is really amazing, isn't it? Especially when you're sitting on your bench like I do and it's 4 or 5 miles away. I think it's beautiful to watch lightning flash and hearing the thunder from afar. But church, listen to me. Stop whatever you're doing and hear this. Think about when lightning strikes close to your home. Please stop and think. How do you respond when the lightning hits your home? How do you respond when your foundation that you stand on, that you thought you had, your money, your job, your reputation, your home, your cars, your health? What happens when thunder starts shaking that foundation? What happens when lightning starts flashing really close and hitting your home? What happens when hardship, confusion, sadness, failure, sickness, disappointment comes directly and hits your home? How will you respond? How will you react? How will your faith stand there then? Will you waver? Will you give up? Or will you stand up for Jesus? Stand on the foundation. Stand on the promised word. Stand on the fact that you know you're a child of God as a believer, and ask the Lord to use all things for his glory, to bring all that's coming and let it bring glory and honor to you, Father. Start out by asking the Lord to receive the honor and glory for the lightning that hit your home. And then use that to fuel yourself to be the people God wants you to be, no matter what happens to your foundation. Because there's one foundation that's firm. There's one foundation that evil cannot destroy. There's one foundation that nobody has authority to destroy. And that's your belief and trust and salvation and gift of knowing you are a child of God as a believer in Jesus Christ, as one who has confessed, one who has asked him into your heart, one has acknowledged him for being the Son of God, one has acknowledged that God raised him from the dead. You shall be saved. You are adopted into family God. You are co-heirs, and your foundation can never be shaken, ever. No one has authority to do that except God Almighty, and he's promised that foundation will always remain firm. You know, God is love, yes, but a holy God cannot overlook the truth and the wrongs. Can I say that again? A true holy God cannot overlook our sins. cannot overlook our wrongs, cannot overlook our failures. He doesn't condemn you. He wants to use it to build you into being the man or the woman or the person God wants you to be, that He wants you to be. He wants you to use it to be stronger in your faith, to be deeper in your word, to have a relationship that's stronger than ever. He would not be holy if He overlooked it. He would not be just. He would be unjust. Psalms 9:7. But the Lord sits a throne forever. He has established His throne for justice. You know, the prophet Isaiah stood before God's throne in a vision. Let's read how he reacted. This is Isaiah, the man of God. Isaiah 6:5. Isaiah, when he saw the glory of God, he said, "Woe is me! I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of people with unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." His very first reaction is, "Woe is me, for I am unclean." This is the prophet, the ordained man of God. He feared standing in front of God. You want to know why? He saw his own life that was stained with sin. He saw that he was not worthy to be in front of the Lord because of his own failures, his own sin, his own bad judgment, his own mistakes, his own choices. Now, I want you to hear this really, really clear, please. Isaiah said, "Woe is me," because he saw himself. He didn't see everybody else's sin. You don't read that there. He does say, "I am part of an unclean nation. I live in the midst of unclean people." But he says, "Woe is me, for I am lost." He doesn't say, woe are they because they are lost. He doesn't say, "Look, my neighbor's lost. My co-worker, woe is he. He is lost." Isaiah, when he saw the glory of God, he said, "Woe is me." He didn't see everybody else's sin. He saw his own. Listen, we need to start by looking inside our own heart, soul, and mind before we ever look at someone else. We should never judge anyone for their sins. We have enough of our own to worry about without judging someone else's. Please, call on the Lord for salvation, forgiveness, and you shall be set free. Ezekiel and Apostle John had similar reactions when they stood in front of God's presence. How about you? What's your reaction? What's your reaction when you stand in the presence of God in your quiet time, when your holy time, when your time where you're sincere with God? Does the thought of standing God before you bring fear? It does me at times, because I have sinned also. We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We're not to judge anybody. We got enough sin ourselves to worry about. Cleanse your own heart. Take care of what's right in your life. And then help your brother, lest he fall again. Doesn't mean shame your brother, destroy your brother, criticize your brother, gossip about your brother, tear apart your brother, laugh at your brother. It says help your brother so he may not fall again. For we all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Psalms 139 will bring light to your heart. Verse 1 says, "You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise up. You perceive my thoughts from afar." Can that verse hit you at home? God's looking at you right now. Right now, wherever you are, He's saying, "I know when you sit. I know when you rise. I know every thought in your heart, mind, and soul." Church, honestly, that should scare us. That should bring us to a place to being humble, a place to where we call for forgiveness, a place where we respect our Father. This is Father's Day. I pray that we have Father's Day every day of the year as we respect and honor the only true living God, the Father of all creation, Jehovah. The judgment and wrath that should have fallen on us was on Jesus. That's why I cry out to you to know Jesus personally. Because we can never, please, I'm almost done. Don't lose me now. Because we can never come close to the throne of God without the blood of Jesus covering us with his righteousness and holiness, we are to always be in right relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. Sure, our salvation's secure when we call on the name of Jesus, but that doesn't give you a clean slate to do whatever you wish. It means every day you will humble yourself. You will gather yourself. You will ask forgiveness for that daily. You were asked for your daily bread. You were asked for protection from evil. And you were asked that his will be done in your life. Yes, Jesus died on the cross and gave us that opportunity, that gift, by shedding his blood. By, in a way of putting it simple, he was kind of like a lightning rod for us. He took the wrath so that we could be set free. So let me ask you, in your home right now, in your heart, soul, and mind, your home, your business, your work, do you see lightning right now? Do you feel the thunder? Is your foundation shaking? Is it crumbling? Humble yourself under the mighty hand of the awesome God and be safe in his arms for all eternity. Humble yourself before God in every way. And lastly, very quickly, verse 6. And before the throne there was that as if it were a sea of glass like crystal. Tells me the Lord is perfect peace. Imagine that. Imagine the sea before the throne of God without not even one ripple. I'm blessed to be able to go fishing a couple times a year down in Virginia at Smith Mountain Lake. I go down there and I can be, first off, I can just be Danny. I'm not a pastor. I'm not a father. I'm not a son. I'm just Danny. I'm not a husband. I go with Larry, mostly always. So I don't even have to be a friend if I don't want to because Larry loves me. He has to. I can just be me. And I sit there early in the morning, late at night, and just look at that lake, and there's usually not a ripple in it. And when you fish, there's no current, there's no lake, there's no ripple unless it's bad weather. And that's only just a glimpse of what John saw in front of the throne. He said it was crystal clear and not a ripple in it. That's peace. The Lord has our past, present, and future in his hands. What's even more amazing is that peace can be yours today. I don't know about you, I need peace right now. I've been asking the Lord for a prayer request for months concerning my father. And I need peace on that. I need peace in the wisdom and direction of shepherding you, this flock. I need peace to know that I've sought out his wisdom, God's, that I've sought out his guidance, that I've sought out his blessing on when to open, how to open, and what to do to keep everyone safe. And I know the greatest tool I have is by asking you to pray with me that no virus will touch the land, this holy land. No virus will touch a single member, a tender, or visitor that comes through the holy doors of this sanctuary. My Father, God, Jehovah, has authority over everything, church. Call on that. Isaiah 26:3. You keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. God's word has made it clear. You want perfect peace? Okay, let's skip it. You're not going to get perfect peace till you see Jesus. But do you want peace? You want to stop the thunder that's racking your foundation? You want to stop the lightning that's consuming your home? Then trust and humble yourself before the Lord. Let his peace pass over you. God doesn't change. He's still on the throne and he still has us in his hands. And all things are under his authority. Let me say that again. All things, evil, sickness, viruses, money, jobs, even our sins, even the things we've done wrong, even the bad decisions we've made, all that's under his authority. He gave that to his son, Jesus Christ, who has done nothing but show mercy and grace and offering new life, fresh starts. Church, we are blessed. We are given this theme from Revelation so that we can enter into his worship even now. So I say that because I'm going to enter into worship next Sunday with you. If you're comfortable, please come. If you're not, no one's going to think the difference. I promise you. Come when you are comfortable. You will continue to live stream. Everyone's peace and relationships different. Everyone's opinion, everyone's health situation, everyone's fear level is different. So please, Barnesville Baptist Church, let's be the example to the world. Let's not be part of the world. Let's be the example of what flexibility is, what respect is, what love is, what mercy is, and what appreciation is. That's our challenge, and I lay it in front of you. I know we can reach that goal because I know we love each other, and I know that we respect each other, and I know we can be flexible. Let's show the world the right path to take, and that's always God's path, God's word, God's direction. And as we sang earlier, let's say, Lord, be out of my vision. Be my heart and soul. We can close our eyes and see the Lord God mighty on our throne. We can feel the thunder and hear the lightning that humbles our souls and know that we're safe in his arms. We can delight in the brilliant crystal flashing around the throne and the rainbow wrapping around it. We can rest in his peace and his authority. We can praise and exalt our beautiful Lord King Jesus with me today. We can worship together if we will only trust and obey. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus than to trust and obey. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for this opportunity. I thank you that next Sunday we will be live. Lord, if it's your will. Again, I pray for peace, protection, love, wisdom, and guidance. But most importantly, besides all that, Lord, I pray you will be honored. That you will be glorified, that you will be exalted. And Lord, please let this little church be the example. We've led in examples throughout this whole time of separation. We've helped our brothers and sisters with live streaming. We've helped with people, other of your churches to get up live so they can continue to worship. We've prayed. You have provided for us in safety and protection and financially. And Lord, I pray that Sunday we will continue to be the example of what it means to be your children, that we will respect everyone's opinion of their health. We will respect everyone's fear level. We will respect everyone's comfort level, that we will respect more than anything else your authority, and that we'll come together and worship with peace and love and unity. Lord, I praise you and I love you. I pray if there's anyone that doesn't know you today, that they'll call right now to the church when we're over. I'll be here for a while after church till noon. I pray that they'll call and we can talk about their relationship. I pray that they will call my cell phone. It's listed on the website. It's listed on the Facebook page, that they'll call and we can talk about their relationship with you. I pray that you will protect us. I pray that you will let us be the fathers you want us to be on this good Father's Day. Father, I'm praying you answer my prayer personally for my own father. Please, please bless me with the answer. Lord, I pray even now that your will be done. I pray that the ones that are not comfortable to come back will have peace to know they're come when they are ready to continue to worship online. And the ones that are comfortable, I pray that they will come, sit appropriately, wear the mask appropriately, respect each other appropriately, and most importantly, honor you. Because it's going to be great. It's going to be fun. It's going to be a celebration that I can't wait for. I pray that your will that we meet, because I can't wait to celebrate the reopening of the in-person, in-gathering fellowship of Barnesville Baptist Church next Sunday, 10:45. Can't wait, Lord. Let it be, let it be. And all God's people said, amen. I want to close with now, if Luke would just pan out for a moment. And I want you to see the final look of what you will see as far as how we will worship. Made a couple little differences. Remember I said everyone will have their own mics. So a couple little changes. This will be where our worship leader, Anita, will sing with her own mic. And we're going to have a time of worship, of singing just one time, because we want to not overdo the singing, because that's how it's spread. Things can be spread quickly. But this is, well, she'll be for her own mic, her own stand. The word will be preached here in this mic. The deacons with their prayers and announcements will be here at the holiness table with their own mic that you can't see, but it's there. If you're doing a special or if you're doing something different, your stand and your own personal mic will be there. The piano will have its own mic so that everyone on the live stream can hear it. If we have an overflow, downstairs will already be set up for the overflow. If we end up using that overflow next Sunday, I promise you, as your shepherd, we'll We'll have it resolved by the following Sunday. I want everybody to be able to worship up here in the sanctuary. But if we have an overflow, thank you, Jesus, please be flexible downstairs, because the following Sunday after that, we'll have it rectified one way or another. We are having no Sunday school our first Sunday, just so we can get used to our surroundings. And the children will be staying with us this Sunday. There'll be no children's church downstairs for June 28th. Service will be a little less. It won't be as long as I'm talking right now. But we're going to celebrate. We're going to worship. And we're going to have an in-gathering like never before. Thank you, Jesus, for all things. To God be the glory. Great thing he's done. See you next Sunday, 10:45, in the house of God for worship. We all need each other to be all that God wants us to be.
We are the church.
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 We serve an awesome God.
We are the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
We are the church.
And we are the church.
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 Church.
We are the church.
We need each other to be all that God wants us to be.
We are the church.
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 And I want to be back in that little church real, real soon.
We are the church.
Happy Father's Day.